The four candidates are, they're not speaking on anything political, this is just to get women for public safety, for their personal safety. So all four will be giving a piece of it. We have a packed meeting tonight. We've got presidential campaigns coming in. We've got our four candidates. So let's go a little bit more this way, and we've got food over there, so that'll work. Wow. Made you a bigger meeting place.
Yeah.
Let's see. I don't wanna. Where do you want me? I'm gonna put these outside. How's that?
Are you sure?
I'm good.
Yeah.
That's good.
So you're the representative for 12, or you're just...
She is. I'm 400% but not actually being around.
So we have your contact, our secretary has your contact information, and excuse us while we finish that.
No, go ahead, go ahead.
Thank you. Sharon, this is Lori with Donald Trump's campaign. She is, will be speaking to her.
Lori, yes. Nydia. Nice to meet you.
That's awesome.
Anyway, it's pretty...
More than literally.
Yes, thank you.
Where's the magnet?
Hi.
No. I started it up in New York.
How are you going to go with the people's records?
I'm just going to get my card.
Sure.
I brought copies.
No, I printed you on the... Right? You don't prep your life. I know them.
That's you. Okay.
I wrote the real campaign, so I had the box direct. They're all coming over. So I drove it 4th of July for her. I told her to invite me. I hope to win, and then she quit.
This is going to be
really well, I think.
I'm Heather Hulsebus. I was like, I know he looks familiar, but if I said because, sorry. You're welcome.
Looking good.
Hey, Nydia.
Good evening. I want to go ahead and get our program started for this evening. I first want to welcome everyone to the Foothills Republican Women meeting for the 2016 year. It's our first one this year. We're excited to have everyone here, and thank you for coming out tonight. First thing I'd like to introduce myself, I'm Heather Hulsebus, president of Foothills Republican Women. My vice president is Ms. Sharon Keating. My treasurer is Ms. Karen Armstrong. My communications secretary, Seanie Zappendorf, and Lisa Johnson is our secretary. So you kind of know who you've got around you tonight, and we'll be here to help you any step of the way. A couple things that I want to do, housekeeping, cell phones, if you don't mind, if you haven't already, please silence those so we can hear our speakers this evening. We're pretty informal here, we're casual. Restrooms are right here. You may hear the alarm sound for the 911 calls that come through. Try to ignore them the best you can. So I apologize for that. And I want to make sure that everybody understands tonight that this is not a debate or forum. This is a meet and greet for our candidates that are here tonight, the four that were invited to come and speak. So at the time that we do questions, the questions may only pertain to the information that they are sharing with us tonight. If you have questions for them that pertain to running for their office, Sharon will tell you about that in just a minute, what we're going to do there. You can either speak with them individually afterwards, or Sharon will explain to you what she's got there in just a moment. But to get started, I'm going to go ahead and ask Sharon to come up and do our prayer.
So just as a little bit of a backstory, when
Heather and I and Seanie and Lisa and Karen got together for our first board meeting or planning back in the fall. I was just like, oh gosh, I'm like, oh my gosh, I just feel like we are in a war. And I don't know if anybody else has that feeling, but these are very critical times. And we have enemies from within and we have enemies from without. And I just learned an astounding statistic, and forgive me, I don't have the exact percentage, but we have more Democrats in this country than we have Republicans. And it was very interesting to my husband and I that Bernie and Hillary were split. So we have a self-described communist and a traitor. Okay? Seriously, this is what we're up against. So do you think that we're not at war? We really are at war. Thank God this room is filled with qualified and godly people, people that I believe are, you know, set on sending us back on the right track. But we do not be, you know, think that this is going to be easy, because we are at war. And there is a scripture in the Bible, Satan is going around roaring as a lion, seeking who he may devour. Seeking whom he may devour. Is he going to devour us?
No.
No. I pray to God he doesn't. But we have to be prepared. We have to know the enemy. And so I just named the main enemy from within, and then all of our politicians are just going that way. There's something in the water up in Washington. But then we have enemies from without. And I really feel like, this is a personal belief, but our biggest enemy is ISIS. And we need to understand that enemy. And so in your packet in the back of the action items, there's some information to get yourself better informed about that, because it's not our topic tonight. So anyway, just a couple of scriptures. John 10:10. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that you may have life and have it more abundantly. So this is all goes with the backstory. And then Psalm 1 is much more encouraging. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. Now, isn't that refreshing? And I really believe if we had some people in office that were of that mindset, we'd be in a whole lot better shape. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man sows, that also will he reap. Now, unfortunately, we've not seen a lot of reaping come around yet from those in Washington. But that is a prayer that is certainly a valid prayer for each of us to have as we are approaching the Lord about the state of our country, and that's Galatians 6:7. Joshua 24:15. And if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, which we know it is for some folks, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your fathers served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites, which were the pagans of the day, and those in the land that you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you tonight with concerns about our nation and our community as our enemies are pressing in on all sides. As a nation and as individuals, we have allowed ourselves to drift away from your holy word, the moorings of our foundation, principles, and strength. Therefore, we are no longer attached to you, Lord, as our source of strength. We have not demanded that our leaders demonstrate moral character. We have believed lies from the enemy that have come through the mouths of self-seeking politicians. We have not demanded that our leaders be servants first with a servant's heart. We have allowed the government to be our provider instead of looking to you. We have allowed our morals and our truths to be eroded and replaced with the elevation of moral failures and corruption. This has carried us to places we do not want to be. We have not held your name up as our banner over our nation. We have grown to enjoy softness and dependency. We no longer praise your name and give your name glory. Instead, we bask in vainglory and allow blasphemy to be spoken over our land. As a result of turning away from you, we are at risk of the institution of laws and rules from another source, the enemy of our souls. May this not come to pass. In the upcoming months, we are listening to candidates and following what they have done. Give us discernment to hear words of tolerance and acceptance of the next wind of doctrine.
meaning let us hear what they're saying and follow the actions so that we can understand the truth. Also, please give us ears to hear words of truth and to recognize actions that reflect that doctrine. I pray that tonight, as we leave this place, we each will search our hearts for the strength to repent and then to humble ourselves and to pray so that our land may be healed. In the meantime, help each of us to stand firm, fiercely holding on to the righteousness that comes from you. And Lord, please be with each of our candidates who have graciously given their time this evening to come and share with us and just to be a part of our community and to invest themselves in our community and in our nation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Can we do the Pledge of Allegiance?
Just a moment. We're getting there. If you'll let me go through my agenda, that would be greatly appreciated. Karen, if you'll please lead us in our pledge.
Sure. If you don't mind standing, please. If you can't, don't worry. Okay. Great.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Armstrong, who is on our school board, and we also have Ms. Seanie Zappendorf, who is with our Downtown Development Authority. Do I have anybody else from the county that I'm missing? No. Perfect. Announcements are going to be next. We have a lot of them. Kind of bear with us. Some of it is some information in your chairs. We're going to explain a little bit about what's going on there. First, I want to go ahead and invite Barbara, if you would like to go ahead and make your announcement about the school board.
Hi there, I'm Barbara Smart. My husband, Dale Smart, is chairman of the Dawson County Tea Party. We meet here on next Tuesday night, the first Tuesday of each and every month, or the second Tuesday, at 7 o'clock. And next week, we have Mike Warlick and Paul Henson to present the Georgians for Fair Tax. That is we have the largest state fair tax organization in the entire country. And three of the members on the board of directors of Americans for Fair Taxation is the national organization, and three of our Georgia members sit on that board. Anyhow, they will come and talk about how the fair tax will be good for our state economy and how it will affect our state taxes. So we invite you all to come 7 o'clock here next Tuesday night.
Sharon, do you want to go ahead and talk about the sheriff's meeting?
Yeah. Okay, so on your seat, you had a packet of a lot of information, and this is the save the date for the official sheriff's forum. You'll see our four candidates in action answering questions to a panel. We are taking questions from the community, so if you would like to take a card, that's the best thing to do, or you can mail it in to, what's the publisher?
There, down here you'll find a P.O. box or an email address. It's going to be hosted by those three.
But we can pass the cards around tonight, so if you think of anything this evening, you want to jot it down, you can leave it with us. Or, you know, you're welcome to mail it or email it in. But the date is Tuesday, March 29th, 6:30 to 8:30, and we have to be very prompt because it's at the middle school. And so we're definitely on a time limit. We don't have any leeway at all there. The other thing while I'm up is also on your seat, there was a list of action items. And often at our meeting, we hear people saying, you know, well, what can I do? What should I be doing? And so we came up with a list of things that are timely. Attend the Georgia Religious Freedom Day. That's next Wednesday, February 10th. It starts at 8 o'clock in the morning. There is a lobbying session, breakfast. Then we go to the Capitol, and we actually speak with them, and then go to the Franklin Graham Decision for America from 12 to 1 o'clock. We have the Sheriff's Forum, the Tea Party meetings, and the Dawson County GOP meetings, and then also making phone calls. And so there is a whole list of things that are very pertinent to our state listed here, and there's just explanation on the bills, but it's highlighted the phone numbers and who you address them to. Also newsletters that you can sign up for that walk you through this process. The information here came from Georgia Insight. Another one that's very good is Americans for Prosperity, and they actually will send you like a form letter that all you have to do is sign it, and then you can send it to the candidate if you prefer email over telephone calling. I would highly recommend that you watch the YouTube What the West Needs to Know About Islam. It is absolutely incredible. And Waleed Shabbat is a former PLO terrorist, and he is absolutely amazing man. He's Christian, and he just tells it the way it is. And his question for the West is, what part of kill do we not understand? And then along those lines, there's a reading list, and they're all very easy reading. The Islamic Antichrist, my friend Sherry loaned to me, and it's such an easy read, but it is amazing, and it just lays everything out. And then Dale loves the 5,000 Year Leap, which I really like as well, and it explains in great detail how our country came to be in 200 years what would have taken the rest of civilization 5,000 years. So.
Sharon, might I make one note that it says the first Tuesday of each month for the Dawson Tea Parties, it's really the second.
I'm sorry. Okay, the Dawson Tea Party is the second Tuesday. Did I get the time right on the GOP? GOP's fourth Tuesday?
Fourth Tuesday.
Okay.
That's how it changed.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. While she's got this fresh on your mind, when you look at the link for Americans for Our Prosperity, so that you know that you're the board here with Foothills, we are going to a leadership program that they are putting on March 19th and 20th, which also happened to be our county convention weekend. So if anybody's, they moved it, it was supposed to be this weekend, but if anybody's interested in that, I have the agenda, it's in Kennesaw. It looks like a very in-depth program on how to get into kind of the nature of politics, membership, and recruiting, which I think you can use in any organization. So I just wanted to put that out there and make you aware of it. I'm going to back step for just a moment on the forum that's coming up so that everybody understands with that one. Due to the time restraints, because we are so limited, and to allow everyone enough time to answer questions, there will be no open mic at that forum. All the questions must be submitted prior to. The committee will choose the questions, so they may have to combine them and figure out which ones according to time. So just want you to be aware of that. And if there's duplicate questions, of course, we're gonna narrow that down to make it much easier and smoother for everyone. In your chair, you're also gonna find a yellow election date card. Some of those dates have changed. I just wanna make sure everybody had it in their hands and knew what was going on. Let's see here. Also in your chair, you'll find a little bit about what Foothills is doing in the community, our contact phone numbers. If you have any questions, please reach out to us. We'll be happy to speak with you. And like us on Facebook. That's how you're gonna find out about our meetings. We do have a lot of email information. We'll email you out to let you know when the next meetings are. This year with Foothills, it's going to be an election year for us as well for our next term. So if you are a member, please start thinking about a possible position. We'd love to have you. Just talk to any one of us and we'll kind of guide you through the process and get you ready. Kind of let you know what we're doing and so that you're aware of how all of this works and how it's all put on. So just keep that in mind, and that'll take place in November at our November meeting, and we'll give you more information as we go. And also for the FRW, we are needing committee chairs for different things that are going on. So if that's on your mind, a couple hours a month, that's all we really need. I know everybody has a ton to do, but we would love to have you see any one of us. Tonight, I'll say this at the end, Foothills is doing a progressive, best way I know how to describe it, raffle.
You'll see a paisley bag on our table back there. Each month, we are going to, or every event that we possibly can, we're reaching out to local businesses, ourselves. We're putting items in there, and it's just going to end up being a beautiful bag. I think we have movies. We have all sorts of different things going on. T-shirts. So just kind of check it out. With the raffle, tickets are going to be $2 each or 3 for $5. And you can see the young ladies in the back, and they'll help you out with that. Are there any other announcements that I need to open up to the floor at this time? If you'd like to go ahead, now would be the time to announce.
We also have somebody running for tax commissioner, Nicole Stewart. You can stand up.
Hi.
Hey.
So you know me on
it.
No. And then too, that I'm probably going to get an evil eye from a couple folks in the audience, and I'm just going to apologize to you now. But we have two outstanding citizens that were in the paper with us tonight. We have Shauna and Cheryl. So I want y'all to know who they are, to put faces and names with the article. So thank you for coming. And also, I'm taking some privileges here. I want you to know that my parents celebrated their 53rd wedding anniversary on Tuesday. And I am honored that they have shown us as children what it's like to have a phenomenal marriage in the way that they raised us. So thank you. Congratulations.
Heather was one of the outstanding. I know she wouldn't say it, because that's why I'm saying it. And congratulations, everybody, about one of the students.
All right. Thanks for bearing with us through all of that. I know we have a packed agenda tonight, and we're going to give everybody the time that they deserve. And this year, we are going to have some really packed meetings that are going to go a little bit over, but we're going to try to do the best that we can to bring you the information that you want to hear. So I'm going to go ahead and get started and let Miss Lori with Donald Trump's campaign come up and speak with us this evening, and let her get this started. Excuse me, Lori.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Lori Pesta. Like she mentioned, I am from Cherokee County, and I am the Donald J. Trump County Chairperson for the Trump campaign. Charlize Byrd is the regional director for all these counties in North Georgia, and she had to go to another county tonight, so she asked me to come and step in for her, and I appreciate her confidence. I also want to thank Heather and your board for a great turnout. This is an election year, so you're going to have a good year when it comes to meetings, meet and greets, and politicians all go together. I used to be president of my Republican women's group in Cherokee County, and I was for 5 years, and the most exciting meetings we had were the meet and greets with all the politicians. So there's definitely a reason for them to come out and keep you informed as voters. And you can share that with your friends and family, because it's important, because a good voter is an informed voter. And that's what's really important in Republican women. We have to keep the public and others in the community informed so that they can vote informed. And a lot of people don't like to do that. They don't want to go to online. They don't want to check out anything. They want information from here to here. So it's always good through the Republican women, Heather, to keep that going. That's really important. I'm going to share a story with you, if I may. It'll just take a few minutes. Many years ago, I personally went to New York City with a group. In fact, it was a Republican women's group, now that I think about it. And we had a meeting up there in New York City, and one of the activities that we had was basically a fun evening. So a lot of us got together, and we went down to the cruise line, and you can take a dinner cruise around Manhattan. And it was really nice, because it was at dusk, and then it got dark, and we had live music, and we had dinner on board, and you know, some of those libations that they talk about from time to time. And it was a wonderful time. And as it got dark, you saw all the beautiful Manhattan skyline, all the lights of all the beautiful buildings. It was really spectacular. And if you ever get to go to New York City, make sure that you take the dinner cruise, or just a cruise in the evening. But as things progressed through the evening and we were cruising along there, I decided to just go out on the front of the boat. I guess you call that the bow? Okay, good, because I'm not a boat person. I take showers. So I went out on the bow of the boat, and I stood there, and I didn't realize where we were on the river cruise at that point in time. And as I stood there, we slowly started to turn and start our journey back. And as we did, there she was, just as tall and as beautiful and as majestic and enlightened as you can possibly imagine. It was the Statue of Liberty. If you know anything about our freedom, if you know anything about liberty, you cannot go out there and you cannot take that cruise and you cannot stand that close to the Statue of Liberty without being just totally chilled. It was a very emotional moment for me. And it really surprised me because I really don't get too emotional unless it's about the dog. So it really was an emotional time for me. And I will never forget that moment. That was a little victory, I guess you could say, in my life. And it's important that we have these victories. And I hope you all have a victory like that in your life. But when I am here now and I see what's going on with our country now, I really find it difficult to say, where is that moment for me? Where is that moment going to be for your children? Because I don't have any children. Where's that moment going to be for my nieces and nephews and their children? What is going to happen to this country in the future? So personally, I am supporting Donald J. Trump for those little victory moments. I want everyone to continue to have those tear-jerking moments, that reach out and touch Lady Liberty moment. And he can do that, because he's going to keep this country straight. He is going to build a wall that no one's going to get across unless they come through the front door. He's going to stop this nonsense with ISIS. He's going to stop giving our country away. He is going to make strong changes. He is going to make America great again. And that's what we need in this country, so that we can continue to reach out and touch Lady Liberty and feel that freedom and feel that awesome moment in our lives, so that we can continue to pass that awesome feeling down to others. It's about God, it's about our country, it's about our troops, it's about our veterans, it's about everything that we love about this country, and we want to keep it that way. We want to improve it, and we want to make America great again. And I hope you will all come to the polls and vote for Donald J. Trump, so that we can continue to have victories. Make America great again. Thank you.
Thank you, Lori. Appreciate your time. Next, I have Ms. Carol Mahoney with Ted Cruz's campaign.
I am delighted to be here tonight to talk on behalf of Senator Ted Cruz, the man who won the Iowa caucus, okay? Against all odds, against the Republican establishment, against the media, against tax by you-know-who. He won Iowa fair and square. And let me tell you why I think he won Iowa. Because as you get to know Ted Cruz personally and his credentials and his accomplishments, then you're going to agree that he is the candidate who can bring God back to the White House and who can ignite, inspire, and mobilize millions of voters who did not vote during the 2012 presidential election. I have been privileged to meet Ted Cruz 4 times and his wife Heidi and the little girls. I co-hosted a luncheon for his father, Raphael, in October. He is a man of God. He does, he says what he's going to do, and he does it. Okay? So anyway, this election, please get to know the candidate. Yes, please be informed. Truth is not rhetoric, okay? There are issues among the voters today that are critical. And what you need to know, you ask them, you say you believe in these conservative principles, show me, okay? For these are the most critical issues, so ask them. Number one, what have you done to fight Obamacare? Or have you talked about it? Ted's first piece of legislation was to repeal Obamacare. He will repeal Obamacare. Two, immigration. What have you actually done? And when I say you, I'm talking about the candidates, to stand up and fight to secure the border and fight against illegal, unconstitutional executive amnesty. Okay? Ted Cruz was instrumental in defeating McCain-Rubio Gang of Eight. Listen to what Rush Limbaugh said. Ted Cruz led the fight against the establishment. We would be living under amnesty right now if Cruz had not succeeded. And that is the truth. Debt. What have you done about the debt that is bankrupting your children and your grandchildren? Right before Christmas, Congress passed that horrific, catastrophic $1.1 trillion budget. An absolute travesty. Part of it included funding Syrian refugees, funding Planned Parenthood, executive amnesty. These budget gimmicks are not what our country needs, okay? It's a pure example of the Washington cartel in action. Ted Cruz voted against that bill. Marco Rubio did not show up to vote. And Jody Heiss was the only Republican in Georgia to stand with Ted to fight against that bill. The First Amendment. What have you done to fight to preserve our First Amendment for free speech and religious liberty? Ted Cruz held two religious liberty rallies, Indianapolis. You can have one. Oh, well, they didn't tell me that. I'm sorry. Okay. He's fought the First Amendment. You didn't tell me that. I'm sorry. Every single amendment. He's a constitutionalist. Okay? First, second, third, fourth, tenth. No one is better qualified to appoint anyone to the Supreme Court than Ted Cruz. He worked for the Supreme Court. The first thing he's going to do when he's president, number one, he's going to rescind every single illegal and unconstitutional action taken by Obama. Two, he's going to order the Department of Justice to investigate Planned Parenthood and prosecute any found violation. He's going to order the Department of Justice, the IRS, and any other agency to stop persecuting religious liberty. He's going to rip up and rescind that horrific Iranian nuclear deal. With that deal, the Obama administration becomes the world's leading financier of radical Islamic terrorism. Three words Obama cannot say. Let me just close in saying what Rush Limbaugh said. If you are looking for a Republican candidate who is most steadfastly opposed to liberalism, whose agenda is oriented towards stopping it and thwarting it and defeating it, it's Ted Cruz. So please, listen to him, tune in to him. There is no dirt about Ted Cruz, and he is the only Republican candidate who has not gone below the belt and accused and said nasty accusations. That speaks to his character, and I hope that you will vote for him. Thank you.
I have information right here.
Are you on the agenda?
I didn't know I had a time limit. I had 6 minutes left.
You're fine. And just so that you are aware while they're taking photos there, we did invite Marco Rubio's campaign. Unfortunately, they were not able to join us. And Ben Carson's campaign, unfortunately, was not able to join us. We do have some information on Ben's campaign over here on the table. and yes, I apologize, Carol, for the misunderstanding about the time tonight.
Well, I wasn't going to go that long.
You did fantastic. I appreciate it very much. Thank you. Excuse me just one moment. I know Carol and Lori, I know y'all traveled from a great distance. If you need to leave, I understand, please do so. We very appreciate your time. Our next guest speaker is going to be Ms. Michelle Miller. She's a candidate for a Georgia Public Service Commissioner, and she's going to come and speak to us for just a few minutes.
Am I tall enough? Can you see me here, or would you prefer me over there? Yeah, I'm a shorty. I'm 5'2". First, let me say I'm very sorry for being late. Usually, I'm the first one here to shake your hand as you enter the building. Technology can be your greatest friend and it can be your greatest enemy. It had me driving around for the last hour trying to find you guys. It took me all the way through Kelly Bridge Road to Etowah to Liberty, which was a dead end. But I'm here and I'm happy I'm here. My name is Michelle Miller. I'm running for District 2 Commissioner of the Georgia Public Service Commission. And I want to share a little bit of information about me and then lead into policy. The first thing you should know is that I was born in New Orleans, Louisiana. I was raised in Marrero, Louisiana. And I was born to a very disadvantaged family, very low education. We had drugs and alcohol in the family. And when I was a young child, my band teacher, Mr. Myers, on my birthday, took me to Oakwood Mall. We sat down and we ate chocolate cake watching over 70 people fly kites. And he told me, Michelle, you can fly as high as that kite as long as you have passion for what you're doing. And all the tools you need to be successful is already inside of you. This literally set me on fire. I felt he handed me the keys to my freedom. And guess what I did? I became an opera singer. I learned how to play 3 different instruments. I was on a TV program called Our Generation with Sally Ann Roberts on Channel 4 News talking about community issues. By the age of 16, my first airplane ride was to Washington, D.C., where I represented the state of Louisiana in the National Bicentennial Competition. I debated members of Congress and a Supreme Court justice on the Bill of Rights and the Constitution. I felt as though they planted a seed in me. They passed that proverbial torch onto me so that one day I can stand up and serve my community. Also, by the age of 16, I became an emancipated minor. I left Louisiana. I moved to Bellevue, Nebraska, where I used to work at Burger King until 3 o'clock in the morning, going to high school at 6:30 in the morning. Never was I on welfare, never was I was on Medicaid. I knew that if I worked hard and I kept focused, I can be successful. So let me tell you what I did with those seeds. I nourished that seed with education. I'm a Penn State graduate in energy and sustainability policy. I won a scholarship with Penn State to Costa Rica with the Green Program, where I studied geothermal, biomass, solar, wind, biofuel, and I'm certified in ArcGIS, which is transmission siting, line siting, route optimization, metadata analysis. I'm certified as an ethical leader in business and policy from the NASPA Center for the Public Trust. I've consulted internationally in China, France, here at home. I even won a military contract with Brook City Base in Texas. So I am very well prepared to work for you on day one. So let me tell you what the PSC does. The Public Service Commission, we regulate electric, natural gas, and telecommunications, but I'm here to tell you we can do so much more. We can be your financial steward and investor. We can be your advocate, and we can be your educator. If everyone underneath the sound of my voice can do me a favor, can you raise one hand for me? And I want you to repeat after me. Can you say, I am a shareholder? Oh, come on. I know you have much more Republican spirit than that. Can you say, I am a shareholder?
I am a shareholder.
Thank you. The reason why I brought you through this exercise is because every single time you pay taxes, every single time that you pay your electric bill, you are investing in the state of Georgia. You are investing in the Public Service Commission, and that makes you a shareholder. That means that as your public service commissioner, I am accountable to you. I am accountable to be your financial steward and investor. Let's talk about that for a moment. Every single time that we make an investment, we need to make sure that you have a positive return because it's your money. That's what fiscal conservative is all about, how to spend wisely and how to reduce debt. But we don't do that on the Public Service Commission. We rubber stamp all those rate increases, don't we? The second thing is that we need to be your advocate. You know, I went to the PSC, I read 5.5 years of transcripts, and I realized that we don't talk to your communities before we pass a $6.9 billion rate increase or a $145 million rate increase. We don't see how you're faring. So what I started to do was call county commissioners around Georgia, and believe me, there's a lot of them. 159 counties times 5, that's a lot of people. But what I discovered is that they haven't heard from your public service commissioner at all. We don't talk to them. And I want to know what's happening with you. And in talking with them, I also realized another problem, which is we don't share information. You see, energy is much more dynamic than how much we pay for it and how much we consume it. It can really be a money saver in your community. It can be a job creator in your community. It can be a tax revenue generator. And I'm going to give you some examples how. Every community make money on the water and lose money on the sewage. Did y'all know that? They do, every community. If you put an energy technology on your water treatment facility, you can eliminate the electric costs. That cost savings can be $200,000 or more, money we can redirect into your budget for much more needed services. Now let me ask you a question. How many water treatment facilities in Georgia do you think have an energy technology on them? None. That's information that can save you money. Secondly, there's another thing that we can do. Do you remember, if you want to attract businesses to your community, what's the first thing your community must do? Do you know? Give tax credits, right? That's your money. What if the public service commissioner works with your local officials and your public utility? So if a business want to move to your area, we can allow them an exemption to finance an energy technology on their buildings. If you have 14 hotels, for example, with the 1 megawatt on each hotel, that's 14 megawatts. And the deal would be, written in the contract, those businesses would have to revert that energy back to the main grid during high peak demand times, which is the most costliest times for your public utility. That's from 5 to 7 a.m. in the morning and from 5 p.m. to 9 o'clock p.m. roughly. So what would happen is the businesses, through that cost savings, can expand more quickly. They can hire more people in your community. Those people have paychecks. They go out and they spend money, which will increase tax revenues. Because all of the businesses who have the energy technologies are reverting that energy back to the main grid, now your public utility have downward pressure on electric bills. Your bills go down. That is what a small government is. It's collaboration. It's us working together in partnership to make sure that we're spending money wisely and we're using technology efficiently. My name is Michelle Miller. I'm running for District 2 Commissioner of the Georgia Public Service Commission. Even though it's a District 2 post, it is a statewide election. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to email me, text me, or call me. I'll have information, push cards, and business cards there for you. Can I take any questions, or? No.
I'm sorry, GPS took you on the live tour of the county.
I know.
I apologize. I didn't even have my phone on me. I want to go ahead and let you know we just had some breaking news in Dawson County. that just totally blows my mind away. Randall Dowling was just named the Dawson County Manager. So for those of you that are keeping up with that, we do have a new county manager, and that's Randall Dowling.
Thank you, Michelle, for bringing that to us. You are awesome.
Now we're going to get into the women's safety part of our program. And our first sheriff's candidate. But she was reminding me to make sure everyone is aware that we put everyone's name in a bowl, and we drew the candidates out from there so that they were picked at random for tonight. So we didn't, it's all just random. Our first one that's going to be speaking tonight is Chief Security Officer, Mr. Frank Sosebee.
Frank. I'm going to hand out some safety tips. I'm doing safety tips and car safety and such as that. This right here, just take this home with you. Look it over. It is some safety tips for you at your house. It may come in handy. It may save your life. What I am going to go over here, if you'd like a copy of what I'm actually going to speak on tonight, I'll be happy to email this to you. My email's on the back of the pages here. But safety, especially in areas of Dawson County, for example, at 1,000 miles, such as that, and where you park your vehicle, you got to be aware when you come out of a store, you may see a large van, a large truck. Now, I move a lot, so you're going to be following me everywhere. Now, I do not stand still. At work, I do not stand still. I actually came from work today. I just changed the shirt, and I apologize for that. But we got 11 new re-entry guys in today, and that's very important to me. They come back to society and save us a lot of money. So, but at the outlet mall, think about your car and you're parked in a parking lot. And you go back out and there's a van there. It's got a slide to one side of it. And you're not thinking, you're on your cell phone, you're walking up to the car. And all of a sudden, somebody slides the door open, snags you and jerks you right into that car. That happens. That's an abduction. We have this problem now where a lot of the young ladies that are ages from 12 to 18 are in a sex trafficking out here nowadays. You can see this. Go online and look it up. It's sad. It's very sad what these ladies and these young girls are going through. So the first thing we need to really think about is awareness. Be aware of your area that you're around. Be aware of who may be standing beside you, behind you. You never know when you may become a potential victim of a snatching, of an armed robbery, somebody coming to stick a gun in your back. You never know what's going to happen. Be aware of your surroundings. The second that I want to talk about is use of your sixth sense. And what I call this is a gut feeling. Everybody's had this gut feeling. You know, you've been in a position where all of a sudden something's telling you, you don't need to do that. You don't need to do that. That happens. Go with that gut instinct. Know that something's awareness again. That's around you. Be aware of your presence. Know what's around you. You just don't never know who may show up. An example, Ben. On a call one time, I had a shotgun stuck in my chest, didn't even know the guy was there coming out of the woods on me. That happened. It's a true story. Thank God I'm still here. But be aware. Use that sixth sense. Learn to trust the powers that you have inside yourself. Know what's around you. Another thing is never forget to escape. Always attempt to run. I know a lot of times I say, just give in. Don't give in. Fight to your last breath. Don't give in on anything. Never, never. There's statistics on that. It says if you will fight, the good opportunity that you're going to survive. Very good opportunity. Don't give in to anybody. Don't be a victim. Just fight. Another one is your right, like I was saying, your right to fight. It's important to understand that you can and should defend yourself physically. No matter how diligently practice awareness and avoidance techniques, we may find ourselves in a physical confrontation. That can happen. It's happened to me. I don't know if anybody else has been a victim or has been in a physical confrontation. I'm sure that Jeff and Tony and Jeff has. And Marcus back here, he's from Wooten County. But I'm sure somebody at one point in time in your life, growing up, you've been in a confrontation. You know what it's like to fight. Learn when you're in this battle, learn to flee. Get away from these people. For example, if your attacker comes up and grabs you and you get away and you take off running, scream at the top of your lungs. Help, help. If you pick a rock up, bust a window out, it doesn't matter. That's your life you're talking about. You've got to get away from these attackers. The next thing is pepper spray. I don't know how many ladies or gentlemen in here have pepper spray, the little canisters may have any keychains and stuff like that. I can give you some pros and cons on pepper spray. Have you ever tested it in downwind and all of a sudden it comes right back in your face? It will do that. It will do that. I'll give you another example. If you're toting it in your purse, you got an attacker coming up on you, how quick can you get it out and spray it? Think about it. And I'll give you an example. It doesn't work on everybody. The very first time I sprayed somebody with pepper spray and with two other officers, we all three sprayed him at one time. All they done was clench down, wiped his eyes, and said, boys, that don't work. So that happened. The very first time I had to spray somebody. And we hadn't had it maybe 2 weeks. So pepper spray doesn't work all the time. The key to this is safety and your survival. So I want to give another example of something here. A home invasion. I know a lot of times we hear this on the news, but it can happen in this county. Home invasion can happen anywhere. Do you have a secure area in your house? I call it a safe zone. That you can go to, that you can lock a door, that you may have a cell phone with you, that you can dial 911 and call for help. And another thing is, have a pepper spray with you. There's no wind inside your house. You can get them that way. And you will survive. Get help coming to you. Next one, and I know everybody's heard of this before, carjackings. Carjackings are predominant. They happen, especially down in Atlanta. What happens at a carjacking is the offender will come at a 45-degree angle at you, blindside. And I know what everybody knows on the blindside, you're just looking on your car, you may try to pull over before and somebody nearly hits you. You got a blind side, both sides. They can sneak up on you like that. And what they're gonna do, they're gonna jump in the passenger side. Or they're gonna jump in and grab you and drag you out. So you gotta be very careful about this. The key at an intersection is to make sure your doors are locked and your cars at all times. That is very important. You'll survive a carjacking by doing that. Travel tips. Just, and y'all may think I'm crazy about this, but just think about it. Everybody knows what a wedge is with a block of wood. Say you go to a motel, and you get in this motel, and all of a sudden somebody, a butler comes up. He's bringing you your food that you ordered, but it's not the right one. He knows you're in there. You make it to the bathroom. That wedge is stronger than that door. That wedge just led into a door will stop an intruder. You can't push open on that wedge. Thank you. I needed that. So it's just something to think about when you go, especially if you're by yourself, a lady by herself traveling. Just be careful. The last thing I have is about cyberspace. Social media for these kids out here. This stuff goes on all the time. There's predators out there online. I'll give you an example of something else, even worse. Is terrorists. They are drawing our young kids in by cyberspace. And it's scary to know that kids are out here nowadays, they're more app to get on a computer, texting or anything else, than going out here playing in a sandbox like we used to a long time ago, getting on a swing set. All that's changed now. Everybody's gone to the computer. You got to watch your kids. You got to protect your kids. Everybody in here, I'm sure, has got a kid. Some may not, but I know everybody in here. Some small, growing up. We've got kids. If you love them enough, you'll take care of them. Now, that's all the tips that I've got. Adam handed out a lot of tips here for you to review. Please read them. If you have any questions or anything about any of this, I'll be glad to give this to you, let you look at it. My name is Frank Sosebee. I am a Republican running for sheriff in this county, and I appreciate you both.
Questions for him tonight before.
What's the open carry laws as it applies to the outlet mall?
I'm sorry, I'm.
What are the open carry laws as it applies to the outlet mall since it's private property?
You can tell the gun. Now some place, I'm gonna tell you a place over in Gainesville. It's called Wild Wings. They've got a sign at the front door that says not to bring a gun in there.
Right.
That's yes. You cannot go. They've got it right there at the front door. When you walk up to Wild Wings, you cannot go in there.
Well, no concealed.
If you got a permit, tote your gun. I'm a big, big fan of toting a gun off duty.
Governor Deal signed that road.
Yes, sir. Yeah. And Coachy, if you tote guns, ladies, men, anybody, and I'm gonna give Jeff Johnson a toot on the horn for this. He teaches firearms. Great instructor.
There you go.
So, and I appreciate that. So, yes, you need to tote a gun. That is too much danger out here nowadays. Anybody else?
Frank, I know you probably need to get out of here tonight.
Well, I don't know yet. I'm sorry. My daughter's got a brand new car, and she's down in Atlanta, and all of a sudden that car quit running.
Oh.
So, and that's it.
So he came
here
first.
These tips are very important. Yeah, I went over these tips.
So we appreciate that, Frank, and we understand if you need to get there, please do so. Thank you, Frank.
Any more questions for you?
And before I introduce our next speaker, I want to drive home what he talked about. Last night, at a small group Bible study here in this county, someone tried to get in the door at the home that I was at. We answered the door, and we closed it. We sent her on her way. She was clearly on drugs. She left, and we sat and waited. My gut check told me this wasn't over yet. A few minutes later, we saw the spotlight from the sheriff's patrol car. I knew who they were looking for. About that time, we realized that several of the girls are not from the area. They all have their cars unlocked. So I went outside, locked their cars, got their keys out of their cars. Some of them had left them in there, and came back in, and she was gone. And it's a very dark road where this house is, so there's not much around. Less than 5 minutes later, she's back on the porch and is trying to get in the door, very quietly, not making a big ruckus, trying to blend in. I did call 911 at that point and got him. But I also want you to know, and I don't know if anybody will touch on this, when you're calling from a cell phone, I did not get Dawson County 911 dispatch. I got Forsyth County, and this was just around the corner. I was very surprised. So I knew immediately what was going to happen, and I got patched through. They were out there, like, looking split, because they were already in the area, and they did arrest her. But I just want you to know, I mean, everything turned out really great. I mean, it was all good, but it just drives home that you never know where you're going to be at when something happens. So I just want to share that with y'all. So it's kind of cool. But our next speaker is Major Jeff Johnson, and he's going to speak to you about gun safety.
And first of all, let me thank you for coming out tonight. I greatly appreciate that. It tells me that you care enough to come out and listen to your candidates. And also thank you to the representatives of Foothills Women Republicans. Thank you very much. Before we begin, I just want to talk to you about a couple of things. Again, I'm Jeff Johnson. I am a candidate for sheriff in this term. Firearms is one of my passions. I've been teaching firearms for the better part of 15 years. I've been involved in it for probably 18 years or better. I know there's a lot of people in this classroom tonight that's been through our firearms training. I know that there's some that's coming to our firearms training. So I don't want to let too many cats out of the bag, but I certainly look forward to having you come, and I've certainly enjoyed having those that's come out to join us. Let me ask you a question, just a quick show of hands. If you don't want to participate, that's fine as well. Anybody here not interested in toting a firearm? Anybody here a little apprehensive about toting a firearm? Just one? We need to change that. Let me ask you a question. And I'll use Miss Karen up here for an example if she don't mind. Miss Karen, do you still have your parents with you? October 16th, 1991, and I hope this kind of resonates home to a lot of folks, because it doesn't just apply to your parents. This could be your children. This could be your aunts and uncles, brothers and sisters, grandchildren. October 16th, 1991, in a town called Tyleen, Texas. Does everybody know where I'm going with this?
Yes. Yeah.
Lucas Cafeteria shooting. There was a lady by the name of Susanna Huff. Susanna was a gun toter. Susanna had a gun in her pocketbook. She was meeting her mother and dad for lunch at a restaurant called Lucas Cafeteria. Yeah. Suzanne got concerned. She was afraid that she might get in trouble for toting a gun into the restaurant. She takes the gun out of her pocketbook and she leaves it in her vehicle.
Oops.
As she's in there with her 71-year-old father and her 67-year-old mother, a car crashes through the front of the building. Now, envision this. Envision you there with your family in Ryan's on a Sunday afternoon and this happens. What's probably the first thing that's going to go through your mind? Got a car wreck, right? Mm-hmm. So what do you think people started doing? They started coming to the aid of this guy that they thought had had a wreck, but they were met with gunfire. A total of, well, Miss Susanna Huff testifies that she went to get her gun, but her gun was not there. During the ordeal, and different reports vary, but there's apparently reported that 23 people were shot and killed, with another 27 that were shot and wounded. Out of those 27 that were killed were Susanna Huff's 71-year-old father and 67-year-old mother. So I say that just to kind of set the tone for you tonight. Does anybody here remember the Newtown, Connecticut shooting? Remember that? And Miss Ann Martin can tell you, we got inundated with permit applications, didn't we? I mean, everybody was coming in. I want to get my permit. Because, and even from our presidential candidates, you know, the federal government, we have a tendency to overreact sometimes. And whenever we have an unfortunate incident like that, what do you always hear on the news?
Gun control.
Not Ted Cruz.
Thank you. And I was joking around with Miss Ann one day, and I told one of the applicants to come in, I said, you know, I don't think the first criminals come in to get their application. And you can understand what I'm saying is that we always want to tend to penalize our law-abiding citizens when things like this happen. Mm-hmm. Now, I think we can all agree, do we have a gun control or a gun problem in the United States?
No.
Do we have an evil problem in the United States?
Yes.
Absolutely. I get folks that come in sometimes where I'm not going to carry. I just want to get my permit in case I need it. And I always try to share the Luby's Cafeteria shooting with them. What if Miss Susanna would have had a gun with her that day? You know how many people were in the restaurant that day? Roughly 140. Now, I'm not saying that they wanted a gun in that restaurant that day, but obviously if it was, somebody didn't take the initiative to respond to it. But how could we have reduced the casualties that day, potentially? So I just wanted to say that to set the tone, and I know I'm limited on time, but I want to talk about firearm safety with you for just a minute. The handout that you got, firearm safety incorporates a lot of things. It incorporates fundamentals, how to use it, where to point it, how to squeeze the trigger, all these different things. But what I want to talk about is, say you're contemplating buying a gun. Is there a lot of different varieties?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So I think we need to determine first, you know, what are we going to use it for? How many of you are play shooters, sport shooters? Is that the same kind of gun that you're going to have then for a home defense? Probably not. Now, what about personal defense? When we talk about personal defense, personal carry, we going to put a shotgun under our coat, Marcus, and go in Walmart? Probably not. So we need to be very mindful and cautious of when we're buying firearms, exactly what we want to buy. Now, what we teach, and ladies, you'll hear it, when we start talking about different type of platforms, weapon platforms, there's certain things as a revolver, and you have a picture of one on your handout. There's also semi-automatic pistols. What's the big difference between a semi-automatic pistol and a revolver? Come on, guys.
One has a magazine, the other has a rotating cylinder.
Absolutely. What I'm referring to is what? The old wheel gun, correct? Now, however, and I see a lot of people come to the reins the first time, and I see a lot of ladies. We'll refer to ladies since this is a ladies' meeting. But we have a lot of ladies come to the range, and somebody else has bought them a gun. Why? Because that's what they felt like they needed to buy. And that's where I encourage you, find something that works for you. Now, I'm a big advocate of the wheel gun. Why do you think that is?
It works.
Simplicity. If I squeeze a trigger on a revolver, what's that cylinder going to do? It's going to rotate, and the hammer's going to fall on the chamber, correct? Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't go off, Mike, what am I going to do with a revolver?
Squeeze it again,
right? Mm-hmm. See, we traded something in law enforcement years ago. When I first started, it was revolvers, and probably a lot of these other ones were revolvers. But we felt like we needed more ammunition. We felt like we needed more rounds. So we began to go to a magazine-fed weapon, semi-automatics. What comes with semi-automatic? What comes with a semi-automatic weapon?
A cammy?
Huh?
Is that what you're saying, cammy?
Potential for malfunctions, right? And I want you to think about this, ladies. Think about if you're in a high-stress situation, if you pull your gun out, and for some reason you're wrestling around, the subject hits the slide, takes it simply out of battery or something like that. Then you've got what? You've got a malfunction. Now, in law enforcement, and those that send law enforcement in here can tell you, we teach and train every year our police officers how to clear malfunctions. There's malfunctions with a semi-automatic weapon that you're not going to encounter with a revolver. And even trained law enforcement officers under high-stress situations, sometimes they have to stop and think, well, how do I clear this? How do I make this weapon function again? So when we teach the firearms and we teach the citizen classes like we do, we really encourage folks, number one, find the gun that works for you. All right, you best be up, Ms. Carey. All right, moving right along. Training, find you some good quality training. Look, it's out there, you may pay for it, but find you some good quality training. As I told you, I'm a candidate for sheriff. We are advocates of teaching firearms classes. We've got one coming up next week that I've already talked to some folks about. We believe in it. We believe an armed community is a safer community. We want you to partake in that. Understand the laws, all right? Not only will we teach you how to use a firearm, but we're going to teach you when you can use a firearm. Very important. We may shoot 100 on the range each and every week, but what if we don't know when we can squeeze that trigger? Is that a problem? Mm-hmm. I had a lady in the class one time, she asked me, she said, well, can I shoot somebody if they're standing in my living room? What is the answer to that?
Yes.
It is the end, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely. And we had a long discussion about that. Okay, what if it is somebody that's coming in a violent, tumultuous manner to do you harm?
Yes.
Probably so. But what if it's a special needs adult that's down the road and he's just wandered into your living room? So there is no black or white answer to this thing. But if you're going to be a responsible gun owner, if you're going to carry it, you need to know the laws. And again, just trying to make this quick, be careful with your carry, be careful with your storage. Make sure that you have it in but be mindful of who's coming in your home. How many of you have small children, grandchildren? How many of you may have a special needs person in your home? You need to be careful how you store your gun. Does that mean we lock it up and safe? I think you've got to find that balance that works for you. What's accessible, but yet what is still secure. So again, please, if I can help you, you've got my information on there. If you're interested in the class, I know I've already talked to a couple, please feel free to send me an email. Love to have you. We enjoy with the sheriff. This is something that we've worked on for the past several years. We've had a lot of classes, and a lot of you can attest to that. We have a good time. We try to keep it safe. We try to keep it enjoyable. And for the most part, if you're not a gun person when you come to the class, you'll probably be after the class. But is there any questions I could answer for anybody? Yes, ma'am, Ms. Sheriff.
This magazine says that if you are
stop for like a traffic ticket or whatever, that you should get your permit out and show it to the officer. I mean, he doesn't even know if I have a gun. So why do I need to show him?
You don't. There's no law that says that you have to tell them that you've got a gun in the car. There's no law that says you have to show them your permit. I can tell you from a personal perspective, is when I used to stop cars and vehicles, that if I walked up to a car and someone said, you know, sir, I've got a gun in the car, I always appreciated that. It always built a little bit of a rapport. But Ms. Sherry, you're under no obligation to do so. Any other questions? All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, he's already ready. He don't need an introduction.
Sometimes it takes a little longer.
That's fine, I understand. Our next speaker is retired Chief Parole Officer Jeff Perry, and he's going to talk to you about how to protect your home. Take it away, Jeff. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jeff Perry. Just want to give a little background experience right here, that you know who you're talking to. I have a Bachelor of Science degree in Criminal Justice from Georgia Southern College. I also complete my Master's degree from the University of North Georgia. I completed the Certified Public Managers Program from the Carl Vinson Institute at UGA. I've been a Chief Parole Officer for 19 years and a Parole Officer for 26. Intern with the Statesboro Police Department for 2 years. And like Jeff, I'm a post-certified firearms instructor, and I've been doing that for 20 years. Numerous hours of law enforcement training, supervisor of G8 Summit, the World Leaders, State Olympic Law Enforcement Command. My wife is here, Lisa Fisher and Perry, so we've been married for 27 years. We have two adult children, the memberships in Rotary Club, Civitan, JC, Sigma Nu Fraternity, Republican Party, NRA, and the Georgia Sheriff Association. I'm a deacon at Liberty Baptist Church, where I currently serve as the Vice Chairman. I've been a Boy Scout leader here in your community, park and rec coach in those sports, and Dawson County resident for 26 years. Talk about the topic is how to protect your home, but they threw me a loop, how to protect your home without a gun. So that, you know, one of the first things I'm going to say, I'm going to be like Jeff, get a gun, learn how to use a gun, but for those people that don't have a gun, this is what we're going to do. Tell you how to do it. In 2014, there was estimated 1.7 million burglaries, but that's a decrease of 10.5% when compared to the 2013 data. Number of burglaries decreased 20.2% compared with 2010, and it was down 19.7% when you look at a 10-year time period, which is, that's good news. The estimated number of burglaries account for 20.9% of the estimated number of property crimes. And if you go by subject category, and this comes from the, everybody can have access to this, it comes from the FBI Uniform Crime Report, or referred to as UCR, the FBI puts it out every year on all types of crimes. So if you look at that, burglaries of residential properties accounted for 73.2% of burglary, which means you're likely to be burglarized at your home as opposed to your business. Home safety tips. Again, right here, you see purchase a firearm and learn how to use it properly. So let's say you don't have that. And Frank and him hit on some couple good choices early on. Pepper spray, taser, batons, clubs, stun guns, knives, self-defense, a hammer. Anything that you get into your hands on a frying pan that will do damage. Wall spray is really good. Try that. Try to spray someone in the eyes with wall spray and see what happens. Also consider installing a monitor security system at your home. I had a friend of mine, he got his home was burglarized, got all his guns, so he goes out the next day and buys a monitoring system. He's had it for 10 years, hadn't been burglarized, so. You know, I don't know if those two go together or what. Don't put, this is what we all like to do. When we go on vacation, we like to post pictures of the beach and where we're at, and we'll be back home in 10 days. Don't do that because criminals, they have access to the web, and they're very active in that. So when traveling, always tell a trusted neighbor that you're going out of town. And they can stop over, pick up your mail, and look over things or whatever. So that's a good idea. Turn down the volume on the answering machine. That was something I wasn't aware of. So when they call, they can't hear that this is recorded. This is recorded very low, so they can't differentiate between when someone's home and when someone is not. Use visual deterrents such as a beware of dogs sign. You don't even have to have a dog or a security system, but you can get those signs. That one guy that when it had something, when you knocked on his door, you hear this big ferocious dog, but it was just a recording of a dog. So nobody was going to go in there. And if you live in a cold climate, make sure to clear sidewalks and a driveway. Landscaping is also a deterrent, meaning you can put these thorny bushes outside your window and some that grow real. Don't trim your hedges, and they're hard to get into your home. Never leave notes on your door for service people. That's a big one. Like, you know, you're going to be gone for a couple of days, or working late, you put a sign on there, so I won't be home until 10 o'clock tomorrow. Just leave the package. But that's a big giveaway right here. So these are all great tips right here. Let me move right along over on a time schedule. Here's some other ones. If your front entrance contains decorative glass or open glass, and you got your home security system in a hallway, when you're looking in there, what can they see? They can see the home security system. So, and if it's like, here's a really neat one too. A lot of times when we come home, we put our keys out, we put them in a key basket, hang them on a key thing. Put this key fob right here on your nightstand, because what you have an alarm. There's mine going on. So that's a real good, keep it right there. Noise and distractions scare people away for something, right? You store your valuables in your closet or in your drawers. That's where the first thing the criminals want to go to when they go in, your drawers. Put them in your kids' sock drawer. You know, they don't think kids have a lot of valuables, and so they won't spend very little time in the kids' room. If you don't, and that's another one on the sign. If you don't have a security system, purchase a decal. Or if you go to somebody's house and they got a security system, say, hey, can you get me a decal? And so you get the best of both worlds right here. Join a community-wide crime prevention program. This is one of the biggest tips right here. Become a member of a neighborhood watch. And that's what we're going to touch on there at the very end. Always check out through a peephole or women before opening your door. Keep your doors closed even when you're home, including a lot of times we have a screen or a storm door. We leave our other door open and forget to latch our storm door. If you just open and you go right in. Garage doors up. Keep blinds and curtains closed so you don't advertise what's inside. You know, somebody's walking by and they see a wooden gun cabinet right there, not a gun safe, and they see all these guns in there, then you're going to be a high risk, high target. Request identification if a stranger claims to be a police officer or other government official. And this is when you're at a hotel too. I think Frank talked about that. Sometimes somebody come up and say, I'm with hotel security. First off, open up. Call down to the front desk and see if they sent someone up. Get a dog. If you don't have a dog, get a cat, but get a lion or a tiger. Here's some stats right here. Where to break in the curtain. Front door 30% of the time. Makes sense. Sometimes we don't even lock our front doors. 23% of break-ins on the first floor windows, which is a little bit easier access than the second floor. Side entry 22%, because sometimes we forget about that. We go in and out of the side door so often we don't lock it. We lock our front door and we lock our garage door. Garage 9%, basement 4%, and second floor 2%. Which there was a tip in there also, don't put stacked firewood or put ladders around your house, because what you do, and that was like the Lindbergh kidnap. I mean, they brought a ladder, but if you keep logs and you keep ladders around them, it's just easy access. I got 2 minutes, okay. This is what I want to talk about. Real quick, neighborhood watch program. If you don't have, if you live in a community, if you live in a subdivision, make sure you get together and form a neighborhood watch program. When we live in a transient society today, where either both parents work, people come in and out, people move, we don't know our neighbors. If you become a part of a neighborhood watch program, you get to know your neighbors.
You get to, it's just someone looking out for someone else. And the good thing about this, if I'm elected sheriff, we would enhance the neighborhood watch programs we have. We would strengthen these neighborhood watch programs by giving you training on what to look for, how to even start a neighborhood watch program. Who can be involved? Anyone can be involved. If you have a community, if you have some houses, get together. Elect a block captain or a neighborhood watch captain. Can I live in an apartment? If anyone lives in an apartment building here, yes, you can start a neighborhood watch program. What are my responsibilities as a watch member? Be alert, know your neighbors, and watch out for each other, right? I'm having to go right now because I'm out of time, but I have this right here. I have some brochures up here, and it has my web, my email address. If you will send me your email address and say you want a copy of this PowerPoint presentation, I will send you a copy. But it has a lot of great information on that. Mm-hmm. Any questions?
Oh, can I make a short comment? We actually had a bunch of robbery at our house because the second it happened, you know, when we were calling all the neighbors down the street, called the first one, oh yeah, I remember seeing that car by your house. Like, no, nobody said a word. Because this is how politically correct our society is now, nobody says a word. Mm-hmm. I call the next neighbor, oh, that's right, you know, saw the car. You know, they're casing the place. Nobody said a word. I called this other place and said, oh yeah, they were actually knocking on their door to see if they were home. He actually called the police department, except the police hadn't, you know, made it, called him back about it and stuff like that. So when we see something suspicious, call. I mean, there were multiple times where I just see a strange vehicle. But I work late, coming home at 11 o'clock at night, and somebody's sitting in my neighborhood just in the middle, you know, beginning of the road, I'm calling 911. This is the second time I've seen it. We need to send somebody out.
Good idea. So we see stuff. A license tag number two.
It's John is very correct. I mean, a lot of times we see something, but we don't want to get involved, or maybe we don't want to report it because they may retaliate against us or be politically incorrect. That's what happened in California with the terrorist shootings there. Neighbors saw the guy across the street in his garage, and people coming and going all different nights, but they didn't want to impose, or they didn't want to seem politically incorrect about that. So stay informed. If you see something, report it.
I actually have a question. If you start a neighborhood watch, can you, we used to live in a neighborhood in Warner Robins where we started one, and we actually got a sign that said a neighborhood watch, neighborhood.
Yeah.
Can we do that here in Dawson County?
You can. And I think Chesity, I think they have a neighborhood watch program. But yeah, you can. One thing that we would put together a program to train anyone about how to start a neighborhood watch program, what to look for, give you some numbers and contacts, and still just getting together with 10, 7, or 8 people, say we want to start a neighborhood watch program. It's good, it's better to be informed and trained in what to look for and how to start a neighborhood watch program.
I was going to say one day, this car pulled up in front of my house and he just sat there, and it appeared it was a workman. And then he was writing stuff down, but I went out and took his picture. Yeah. I thought, well, you know, exactly. It turns out something bad happened. I caught his picture.
Yeah, well, everybody's taking pictures now with cell phones. I mean, it's so much harder to do your job now. You're seeing the blowback that law enforcement officers across the country are having. So, yeah, I mean, take their picture because someone's going to be taking your picture. You can believe that. All right, thank you all.
And our next speaker is going to be Public Information Officer Tony Wooten, and he's going to talk to us a little more about how a little one-on-one self-defense.
All right, I usually do the part he just did, so you got the good call. Most of my career I've been out talking to people and telling how people do different things like this that you've heard earlier today. So it's a little bit of a challenge for me because that was kind of my passion that I've been doing for years. Jeff mentioned Neighborhood Watch. I have created Neighborhood Watch. He mentioned Chesity. Chesity was one that I was a part of. I did the Neighborhood Watch for Chesity. Neighborhood Watch is a tricky thing. I'm going to tell you why. We've got some good neighborhoods here that the neighbors know each other well and they like each other. It works real well. I'll go into a little quick story real quick. A few years ago, if you remember, there was a Georgia Tech student that lived in Dawson County that was on the terror list, and they ended up taking him down. Well, they lived in Dawson County. And the subdivision that they lived in, I taught neighborhood watch to. I formed neighborhood watch in the subdivisions, half in Pike and half in Dawson. I felt real proud of this, and I didn't get the accolade that I wanted. But the FBI had actually went into that neighborhood and did surveillance several times. And because of the neighborhood watch, so this is a good plug for this, neighborhood watch, because it was so good, we kept having neighbors go out and say, who are you and why are you here? You don't belong in our neighborhood. So the FBI had a hard time. Now, I asked the sheriff, I said, can I like get accommodation from the FBI or something? Because I had a really good neighborhood watch program. The FBI can't do surveillance. I feel pretty proud of the fact that we already have that. Neighborhood watch is tough, though. It's tougher than it sounds with a lot of issues we've got. A lot of times, if you look at Dawson County, you see that there's a lot of people who live here that work other places. They're not real known to their neighborhoods. They don't really know their neighbors real well. So you kind of got to be careful because of the other side of that. I got a call, and if you're familiar with this, there's a place called Moss Estates in our county. It's never been an area that's been a great place. There's some good people that live in there. Unfortunately, there's some bad people that are in and out of there. There's some transit people. A lady called me, just moved in there, and she said, I want to start a neighborhood watch program. I said, where do you live? And she said, Moss Estates. I said, you do realize that you'll be telling the criminals next door, hey, I'll be gone this weekend. If you see anything you like, just tell them yourself. So it only works when you have people that care about each other. And that, not that that can't happen. We got great communities in Dawson County, great subdivisions that can do this kind of stuff. It is a challenge. We've had a lot of people talk about it. Some subdivisions wouldn't do it because they just couldn't get the number of people together that wanted to do it. So it is a challenge. It's an ever-evolving thing going on with our community, being that people move around. Real quickly for me, I am Tony Wooten. I'm running for sheriff in Dawson County. I've been your public information officer. I've run the jail, I've run the courthouse, warrants, patrol, investigations. And while they're talking about different things a while ago, you saw some of the stats that Jeff just showed about the burglaries being down. I'm very passionate about that. I always have been. I believe that if you want to talk about self-defense and timeless in, if you want to talk about self-defense, you have to start with law enforcement being proactive in your community, stopping problems before they happen. When I first took over as major and captain in his major in patrol division investigations, when I ran that, I really targeted hard thefts. I wanted burglaries down. I wanted break-ins of cars down. And I'm proud to say in 3 years of that I was there as captain and then major of that division, I reduced the burglaries by 36% countywide, and I reduced car break-ins by 25% the first 2 years. So it is something we can do together. You may have mentioned a while ago, people in the neighborhood said, you know, I didn't call. We begged. I ran newspaper articles over and over and over through the community news, which is now Dawson News. We ran all kinds of things saying, please call us, tell us. We have situations that you would believe that people come out and see at 2 a.m. a group of kids walking down the road. This one particular guy saw at 2 a.m. this group of kids walking down the road, and he said, well, I thought they looked suspicious. I knew they were up to no good, but I didn't call anything. The next morning at 8 o'clock, when he went out to get in his car to go to work, they'd stole stuff out of his car. Might have been a little poetic justice there. But we encourage these people to do this. We encourage people to call us, give us the tips, help us out. We work together. It's got to be a partnership with the community and the sheriff's office, and, you know, in the state patrol and everybody else that works here in Dawson County. So we work together to do those things. During my tenure, I know people talk about the Alamo. There was no smash and grabs during my time as either captain or major in that situation, because we turned up the heat. We turned up the heat on these people in the places that we know that there are going to be problem spots at. And we make sure that we do that. We reduce crime. I was so passionate about burglaries. I remember talking to a friend of mine who works with us. We were going hunting together. We were going to Kentucky hunting. And he said, okay, it's been 2 years. We've reduced burglaries. When is it enough? And I said, as long as there's one, there's one too many. As long as there's two, there's an epidemic. I mean, in my opinion. And I tell you why. Some people don't see burglaries as important as others. It's just the truth. Some officers don't see burglaries as important as others. But for me, and we've had the situation almost happen once here in Dawson County, let's say that you have the person that's knocking on the door and trying to see if anybody's home and nobody answers. He goes into the house because he thinks no one's home, and you step out of the shower. Mm-hmm. Now, you just saw the guy that did this doing your burglary. He may not be so willing to let you go call the police. Mm-hmm. He may not be so willing to let you testify in court. Mm-hmm. So that simple burglary that some people say, well, they're just, you know, it's just a burglary where they stole stuff, is now turned into a murder. Mm-hmm. right? So it can escalate very, very fast. So that's the reason why there is no simple crimes. If you want to stop big crimes, you stop small crimes. That's the way to handle crime. In any community, in anywhere that you go, you look at from New York City to Dawson County, Georgia, if you want to stop crime, you go after the little things, the broken windows theory. I've been tasked with doing self-defense. This is a kind of a tough situation. I told Heather outside, I'm not mad, but the average stat of teaching somebody one move in self-defense is it takes 10 hours to get that person trained well enough to use that you just taught them. So unless you want to go to, what time is it? You can, unless you've got breakfast coming in the morning, I'm going to make this quick tonight. We're just going to go over a few little things. They talked about it earlier. For me, though, the number one thing that we teach, I've taught kids in high school. We used to have a seniors class there that I love teaching those girls because they're getting to go to college. So I go in and teach those. I've taught self-defense for years to women in the community. I'll brag a little bit. One lady, I think she actually gave me a mild concussion. She's a teacher at one of the schools. I didn't feel too bad because she went home. Her husband said this stuff didn't work. She kicked him over the couch. So, I felt pretty good. That's another one. I thought I should have got a letter of accommodation from the husband saying, hey, I appreciate you teaching self-defense to my wife. It's kind of tough, like I said, to do this in a short amount of time. So the number one topic that you know that I want to talk about, and Frank hit on it just amazingly while ago, is the fact that you've got to pay attention. I mean, that's the number one thing. I'm married to the greatest woman in the world. I love her to death. She's the most amazing person. She grew up with a pastor's daughter. She's been all over the world. She sang in campus choirs and everywhere from LA stadiums to overseas. She's been all over the place. And we got married. My wife was the most trusting person, and she would go to the city of Atlanta and walk down through the neighborhoods and talk to everybody. I mean, I'm not that way. Obviously, in law enforcement, you get kind of jaded a little bit that you have to pay attention to your surroundings. And that's the number one thing, is to pay attention to your surroundings. Because usually you can find out, I did for a little bit, I don't believe that's a gut feeling. I'm a Christian. I believe God gives us opportunity to feel, see things that He wants us to see, that we don't get into those situations, that He helps us get that information to us. I believe that. Maybe I'm wrong, but I'll go to my grave. So I've had those same things. Other people have had those same things happen to them. I know everybody here that's been law enforcement has. So the number one thing is pay attention to what's around you, your surroundings. And the second thing that I teach every single time to these women is use your voice. That's what some people don't talk about enough. Use your voice. I don't know if you just saw this movie, but I love it. I love the movie that just came out. I just lost the name. That's how it works, right? The what's that Christian movie those brothers made? It just come out. But no, not Heaven. The other one's just...
The War Room.
Thank you, War Room. War Room.
Recommended by Ted Cruz.
If you... No place or anything. Great movie. If you haven't saw it, you should see it. But War Room, there's a spot there where this guy's starting to rob these two women. And she basically says, I'm not giving you nothing. I plead the blood of Jesus over you. You ain't getting nothing. And, you know, obviously that's a decision you have to make. Those officers in that was acting, obviously. And they said, they could have hurt you. He said, well, they could have. But, I mean, that's a decision you've got to make. I'm not saying don't give them your stuff. I think you got to do what's best for you to be safe. But in that situation, if you bark back, if you make sure they realize that you're not an easy target, most of the time they're going to seek somebody else. I'm telling you. Because the one thing that we know for sure, I mean, I think everybody can agree on this, is most criminals are lazy. So if you're not an easy target, you make it work. And if they wanted to work, they'd go get a job. So make it hard for them to do those kind of things. Make it really challenging. If you get confronted, they mention the little car alarms and different things. But make sure that you scream, that you yell, that you do everything that you can. And that's the biggest thing for me. I can show self-defense moves, but we'll be here all night, so I'm not going to do that. I am Tony Wooten. I'm running for sheriff at Dawson County. If you have any questions, I know she's giving me the 30 seconds.
How about a 3-pound weight in the purse?
I believe, and I teach this every time, I love guns, don't get me wrong, I'm a Second Amendment supporter, just like everybody else in this room.
Just a regular weight.
Yeah, but you have to be, to me, to a certain degree, you have to be able to learn to use what you have been given by God. Because you're not going to always walk around with your gun on your holster. If that was not true, law enforcement wouldn't learn how to fight. So you've got to learn how to defend yourself to a certain degree. I'm not saying, I don't teach women to be like, how to just busted your nose, how'd that feel? I'm talking about to survive, to get away from the attack, to go somewhere else, to get help, to survive. Any questions? Other than that one? Yes, ma'am.
I've got a good one for you. My son lives in Florida, and this guy came up to me trying to sell him drugs. And my son, he puts his hand on her and says, Jesus loves your brother, and the God is to both run.
Yeah, I'm a believer, so.
Yeah, I just really can only protect what you have. I mean, should try to make it harder for people to rob. Because we had somebody just ran him out on the road. They shot our friend to see the response time. The police would come, I think it was like maybe 5 minutes or something. And so, you know, we're all fenced in. We had an extra car, we parked in front of it. Because you can't control other people, dude. You can only protect what you have. So the harder you make it for them, the harder it is, you know.
Use some common sense. I went to Miami one time, and I had to open my jacket at night to get them to buzz me in to get into the Pizza Hut. I didn't eat there. I mean, if it's that bad, and I gotta get buzzed in, I'm going back to the hotel and walk in the room, put the rocks they talk about, get in the gun, lay it on the counter, get my key fob, and order takeout. Thank y'all. If y'all have any questions, I'll be here through the rest of this. Thank y'all for having me tonight. Thank y'all for supporting me.
Thank you everyone for coming out tonight. I'm going to wrap this up real quick. I want to let you know on your way out, there's a little table on the back. Miss Nydia brought us some books about the Sunshine Law. So please, those are complimentary. Please feel free to take one. They're the red and blue books on the little table as you're going out the door on the left. Thank you. We appreciate that.
You're welcome, Heather.
I want to thank all of our guest speakers tonight. You did a fantastic job. We're very appreciative. All of my guests for coming out tonight. I do want to go ahead and plug Foothills that we are always taking new members. Membership is due. This is the first of the year. So general membership for women is $30. Men, you are our support system. You are the backbone of this club. We appreciate you. You can be an associate member for $20. The only thing is you don't get the vote here. Sorry. you just don't have voting rights. That's the only difference in our bylaws.
That's prejudice.
We do. There is one thing that we missed in our announcements tonight. On February the 10th, there is the Georgia Religious Freedom Day down at the Capitol. So if you're interested in that, there are some flyers in the back. We do have our raffle, and we do have a drawing. Did everybody get a ticket, a red ticket? Have a red ticket when you came in tonight. If you did not, raise your hands, and we will have one of the ladies get you a ticket. It's past my bedtime.
Third time is a charm.
Okay,
Did you pay off for that?
Yo, what's up? Yeah, we retired.
Hi, wish you had.
Not now, Johnny class.
Right, well, we don't have.
And then I'm hearing his dad. I don't know.
And I was 8'4". She called out 8'3".